Okay, so welcome to ISRE, a very own chapter, and already Akash has briefed about me, so there is no more further introduction about me. And today's topic that is a reference system components and selection. So I would like first of all, refrigeration, since we all are associated with ISRE, so we all know what is refrigeration, but still I will just brief you what is refrigeration. As you know that any heat transfer takes place from hot to cold. But in refrigeration, what we are doing is transferring the heat from the colder atmosphere to the higher atmosphere. So it involves a power to get that heat transfer from colder atmosphere to hot atmosphere. That is what the refrigeration is, and hence the refrigeration comes at a cost of electricity, cost of power. So refrigeration is very much a cumbersome process. It is not just as seen in the screen that we have only four components, but it's a very tedious process. Those who are facing theoretical wise, it is very much simple that by saying that we then all we have is a four component, but practically there are various components, and each component plays a very much important role in forming a refrigeration cycle. And hence, to know the refrigeration, it is very much necessary to know its components, its all parts, so that our refrigeration system works smoothly, properly. So designing is very much important in refrigeration system, and without that, no refrigeration system will work, and unnecessary, it will have inefficient cycle and lead to more power consumption, inefficient system, which is the need of the day to provide the refrigeration system to all our requirement, because refrigeration cools the basic necessity of our life, that is the water, air, and food. So to preserve all this thing, we need refrigeration and air conditioning system in future also, because as seen in COVID today, we are already facing. So it is very much important to give clear and good quality of water, air, and food. And that all can be achieved with the refrigeration system only. So refrigeration system is nothing but, as I said, it is the transfer of heat from cold to the higher system. This is, and it is the application of refrigeration is endless. You can have the refrigeration system for any purpose. Just recently COVID case, you all know that without refrigeration, without cold chain, the vaccination is not at all possible. So refrigeration is very much important in today's date, and to know the refrigeration is very much vital. And so I request all the members, apart from the mechanical and refrigeration field, to join the ISRE, because you all know, even the doctors today has to get the knowledge about how the refrigeration or air conditioning systems work. So refrigeration is a very much important part in today's days, just like air, food, and water, what we have. So the refrigeration is also the same thing. This is the refrigeration cycle, where you can see that it has so many parts. The major part is the evaporator, condenser, compressor, and the expansion valve. These four parts are the major parts in any refrigeration cycle, without which no refrigeration cycle can work. But apart from this refrigeration component, there are other components also which plays a very important role, like the oil separator, which is very much necessary to prevent the carryover oil to the refrigeration equipment. Likewise, it will not only have a hindrance of the refrigeration system, but also protects your compressor by giving a proper lubrication. Suction accumulator is also another component, which is very much important to prevent the carryover of liquid to the compressor. So all these parts are very much important, from reservoir, from side glass. All parts are very much important in refrigeration cycle, and they play a vital role in developing the refrigeration system. So these are the major components what we are using in refrigeration system. That is the compressor, evaporator, condenser, receiver, expansion valve, control devices, and panel, motor, and electrical accessories, etc. Is there someone has raised a hand?
No, sir. Not yet.
So first part is a compressor. Compressor is nothing but the heart of a refrigeration cycle. But before that, I would like to also say that refrigeration cycles are also, there are three types of refrigerant cycle. One is a compressor, second is a absorption, and third one is a adsorption. So we will cover here only the refrigeration cycle, compressor refrigerant cycle. And so the compressor is the heart of the compressor refrigerant cycle. What does a compressor do? First of all, the compressor removes the refrigerant from the evaporator in form of a vapor and compresses the gas to the higher pressure and send it to the condenser for further liquefaction. And that again, it comes to the evaporator to make the cycle continuous. So that is the work of a compressor, just like a work of a heart in our body. So we say that compressor is the heart of the refrigerant cycle. But there are various types of compressors available in today's market. So to select the compressor for a refrigerant system is very much vital and important, that what kind of refrigerant system you are going to build, whether it is air conditioning, refrigeration, cryogenic, how much the temperature you want. So based on every requirement, you have to select the compressor, and then only your refrigerant system can be built in a good level and have a efficient workable, so that to reduce the power and the increase efficiency of the refrigerant system, that is the COP, what we call as. So basically there are five types of refrigerant compressor which are available in the market. First is a reciprocating compressor, second one is a rotary compressor, third one is a scroll, fourth is screw and the Sentry. The three photographs I have shown to you, the first one on the left hand side is the reciprocating compressor. The in between middle one is a rotary compressor, and the third one is a centrifugal but magnetic type of compressor, which is the latest technology. We will cover it later on. Reciprocating compressor is just like an engine type, what we call as. It's an where the piston reciprocate between the top end and the lower end. So it's just like an engine. Hello.
Sir, there is one hand raised by Mr. Akash Gupta. Can I allow him to talk?
Yes, please. हाँ काजी.
एक मिनट अब उन्होंने लोअर कर दिया. But there is another person. Hello. उन्होंने भी लोअर कर दिया. Akash ji, you have any hello?
No. Actually, it was a mistakenly why.
Okay. So I'm requesting everyone, if you have any questions, so please put it on chat so that we can take it.
Put in the chat box.
While having the presentation. Okay, sir, continue, please, sir.
Thank you. So reciprocating is nothing but a compressor, just like what we have in car engine. So where the piston reciprocates between the top and the bottom end, and likewise compressing the gas. And the refrigeration cycle is created. The second one is a scroll compressor. Scroll compressor is a compressor which are circulating in a direction, and not like a reciprocating one, which is reciprocating from top end to bottom end. In scroll, the direction is circular one, and in this, the two spiral coil. One is a static spiral coil, and second one is a rotating one. So in the fixed static, that is a static spiral coil, the rotating one gets rotated, and it's just like an orbital direction, and thus compress the gas. Yes. Likewise, the rotary one. So majority of people have a confusion. What is the means? They say that rotary and a scroll are same, but no, the rotary and scroll are both are different. In rotary, it is again the piston, but piston moving in a circular cylinder. So likewise, it is compressing the gas between the piston and the cylindrical wall and creating the compression effect and the refrigeration effect. So it is again a rotary effect is been there. So it is called as a rotary compressor, while as in the scroll, that is a two spiral coil which is rotating and creating the compression. So both are the different technology, scroll and rotary. The fourth one is the screw technology, which is very much in this today's world, because to reduce the that has reduced the power drastically. And so this is the latest technology, what we call as not the latest technology, but it is also nowadays it is a 20-year-old technology. But in India, it has been seen from the past 5 years. So this is also a good technology where the gas compresses between the two screw lobe. One is male and one is female. In between these two screw lobe, the gas gets compresses and the refrigeration effect gets created. So we can increase or decrease the RPM of the screw, and likewise we can have a very much efficient system by using the screw technology. And the screw technology is also very much used, just like in reciprocating earlier, because it can caters to the pressure differential, heavy pressure differential, so that we can use for the minus application also. And the last one is a centrifugal compressor. Centrifugal compressor is again the efficient compressor, because it is just like a pump, what you have seen, the vanes rotating in a volume. So by that way is creating the pressure, but as you all know that pump cannot create much differential pressure. Similarly, in centrifugal compressor also, we do not have a much pressure differential. So it is not applicable for minus application, and it is very much restricted to plus application, but for a huge system, it is been compared to what scroll and rotary are. They are basically used for our air conditioning and smaller system, while centrifugal chillers are basically used for a central AC where a huge capacity of refrigeration is required. And nowadays the almost the magnetic centrifugal chillers has come, what I have shown you earlier in compressor slide. So likewise, in magnetic centrifugal compressor, we are achieving the IKW per TR below 0.3, which is unbelievable compared to what we have studied at our time, that any refrigeration cycle used to have around 0.8 IKW per TR. But nowadays, the refrigeration cycle are going below 0.3 IKW per TR due to the uses of this latest technology and gadgets, what day by day are coming up. So centrifugal system are the now the very much a common system used in today's world, with the magnetic one in the one step ahead for a bigger system. So that's what we are building right now. So I have already covered this reciprocating compressor. You can see how this reciprocating compressor looks from inside. This is a crankshaft on which the piston connected with a connecting rod and reciprocate in a liner, cylinder liner, and likewise compressing the gas from top end to bottom end and creating the refrigeration effect. This is the picture of a semi-hermetic. In this, the motor is not separated from the compressor. It is built on the same shaft by putting the rotor on the shaft and having our electrical winding as a stator on the body of the compressor. And likewise, on a single shaft, the compressor is built, which is called as a semi-hermetic reciprocating compressor, which is nowadays very much helpful to avoid the leakages in the freon gas. And that's what we are over here, to prevent the leakages to protect our ozone layer in RAS. So these are the compressor what we are using in today's date, particularly for minus application for bigger system. This is the scroll compressor, as said you earlier. You can have the cross section of the compressor, how it is seen, that the orbiting scroll rotates within the fixed scroll. So likewise, the compressor effects is there and it is being created. Further features are added in this compressor, likewise using the dew bearing and all this thing to protect the compressor, because this is a very much good efficient compressor, just like a screw one for a smaller air conditioning system. But at the same time, this compressor also needs very much safeties to protect this compressor, because it is an unrepairable compressor, and once any internal parts has been break, we have to replace with a new compressor. So it is a very costly effect. So to use this compressor in a refrigeration system or air conditioning system, we have to use lot of components, other components, to protect this compressor from damaging. So this is a screw compressor, but again, there are the in screw also, the another technology which has come up is the single screw compressor, in which the screw compressor is been rotated between the two star wheel, and likewise the compressing effect has been created. And this is the compressor which is very much effective than the double screw compressor. So likewise, single screw compressor are very much used in today's date compared to the twin screw compressor, which is a little bit having a more power consumption and more, which is not more efficient than the single screw. This is a centrifugal compressor, just like a volute rotating in the vane.
Sir, there is one question.
And these are the compressor which I use for the, yeah, definitely, please.
Sir, there is one question from Mr. Anand. He is asking me, what do you mean by minus application and plus application? That is the first question. The second question is reciprocating compressor used commonly in today's systems?
Yeah. Definitely the reciprocating compressor are used in all systems from plus application round. And plus and negative is just like air conditioning. Air conditioning is a positive application, what we are talking about. And negative application is the frozen food and COVID vaccine, what you have seen, that we require temperature below 0 degree, that is from minus 20 to even the ultra low, that is the minus 70, minus 80 degree temperature we have to achieve to protect that vaccine. So that are the negative application. And in that, the reciprocating compressor are very much used because it has the greater power to compress the gas from lower to the higher pressure. Pressure differential is much more to create a negative application. So that is been catered by reciprocating compressor very much. So reciprocating compressor are very much used for the negative application compared to what the positive air conditioning application. Because in air conditioning, we can go for the less efficient compressor, just like a scroll or centrifugal, which are consuming less power compared to the reciprocating. So we are using, nowadays we are using reciprocating only for the minus application more than the positive application. And all our positive application, as you are seeing in the household AC, and even the bigger malls and all these things, chiller plant, that all compressor has been replaced by centrifugal, screw, scroll, rotary, and all this thing. And the reciprocating has gone. The reciprocating is only been used in now frozen industry, that is the food, dairy, and all this thing, where high load is there and negative application is there. Okay.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank
you. So this is a centrifugal compressor, what we are talking about. So they are the high efficient, but again, it is for positive application only. Since they cannot create the much pressure differential, we cannot use for the negative application. That is a minus application. Now come to the second most important part of our cycle, refrigerant cycle, that is the evaporator. What is the evaporator? Evaporator is nothing, but in that our refrigerant gets boiled, it gets evaporated. So it is named as evaporator. And likewise, it extracts the heat from the surrounding and gets evaporated. The refrigerant gets evaporated by the lower pressure created by the compressor. So it is nothing but an heat exchanger, where it extracts the heat from the lower temperature and evaporate, and it is transferred to the compressor. So evaporator is nothing but a heat exchanger, and it can be created in any form based on the application. We can make evaporator as per our design, and also based on various requirement. So it is not any thumb rule, or there not any formula that particular evaporator should be like this only. You can create any evaporator based on your application, based on your design. So this is the what I like in refrigeration system, that we can design refrigeration as per our requirement. There is no any thumb rule or no anything formula that we have to use this evaporator only. Nowadays, you must have seen that there are various types of evaporator used, just like in AC and fridge, there are coil and fan. So it is transferring the heat from a room to the another compressor suction and discharge it is creating. So it is what we call as a fin and tube type evaporator over there in AC and fridge. In chiller application and other application, we have a saline tube type heat exchanger, or we can have a PHE type of heat exchanger. So likewise, we used to design the chiller plant and other heavy refrigerant system based on the requirement, and to make the system compact by using the PHE in other system. So that is how the evaporator, again, there is a type of evaporator. Another type, so is the falling flame evaporator. Tube and tube is also there, tank and coil. Just like what we are creating heat exchanger, the same way evaporator can, because it is nothing but a heat exchanger. So we can create various form of heat exchanger from any shape, any size, you can create the evaporator. You can see these are the two types. That is the DX evaporative fin type direct coil evaporator, just like what we use in AC and fridge. And this is a saline tube evaporator, what we are using in our chiller plant. The basic criteria what we have to consider while designing the evaporator. It is not like that what I have said, that you can use anything like evaporator, but we can use it, but we have to design first of all. And that design is based is on our application, you have to first of all calculate the heat load capacity of your refrigeration system for which you want to create it. Then you have to also select the MOC of the operator. Based on that only you can design any operator, otherwise it will not work and your refrigeration system will collapse. So MOC is also very much important in designing the U operator. Likewise, in air conditioning, all thing we are using the copper, but we cannot use copper as in another like ammonia refrigeration system. There we have to definitely use for SS or MS because copper is very much corrosive to ammonia. So likewise, MOC is very much important in selecting for a particular refrigerant system. Once you select with all this calculation of heat load has been done, MOC has been selected, then after you have to calculate the proper heat transfer area, how much heat transfer area will be required for that particular extraction of heat in a new operator. So that is again very much important, and then only you can design a new operator. So calculation of heat transfer coefficient, and that calculation also is not just you have to design, you have to design based on all the parameters, including the medium you want to cool, including the refrigerant you're using, the velocity of the refrigeration. So all aspect and all parameter has to be done before designing of your operator. The type of medium used, also again the efficiency, because it involves the cost to make any evaporator, heat exchanger, it involves the cost. So at the same time, you have to see the difference between the capital and the operating cost. So likewise, efficiency is also very much important in designing the evaporator. The flexibility, how it will work, and whether we have the flexibility or just like nowadays we are using the pH in the evaporator, so that if at the time of actual implementation of system, if we feel that the area is little bit less, we add the plates to the evaporator and likewise increase the area without making the system without canceling the system. So likewise, we are having the flexibility that at the same time we can increase the efficiency or increase the capacity of the system, and the compactness definitely. So today, in today's world, as such, there are a lot of material has come. So as compact as we can make it, even we can go for the sandwich type of PHE, where we have done great reducing in the compactness of the system by reducing the size. Condenser. Condenser is just like a heat exchanger only, just like an evaporator. But the principle is different. In this, the refrigerant get condensed and hence it is called as a condenser. The refrigerant which has been evaporated from the evaporator has been compressed in the compressor to high pressure, such that it is compressed to a high pressure, high temperature, so that it gets cooled to the medium which is available to us. Likewise, if you want to go for air cool condenser, we have to consider the ambient. So likewise, if you want to go to water cool, we have to consider the cooling water temperature. So condenser is also a heat exchanger where it throws the heat which is extracted from the evaporator and condensing the refrigerant in the heat exchanger, which refrigerant again it has been fed to the evaporator to carry on the cycle. And just like evaporator, these are also in many form, from saline tube, from PHE, any form of condenser also you can form. Today you have an evaporative, atmospheric, adiabatic condenser. So a lot of form of condenser have also come up to increase the efficiency, because condenser plays a very much important role in the efficiency of the system, because based on the discharge pressure only you can reduce your power. So as good as your condenser is, as good as your refrigerant system efficiency is. So condenser is also again a very much important part of the refrigerant system to not only carry on the refrigerant cycle, but to decrease the power consumption of the compressor and the refrigerant. You can see in this how various type of condensing unit has been used. This is air-cooled condensing unit, water-cooled condensing unit with saline tube condenser, evaporative condenser. In this evaporative condenser, there are tubes fitted with a film. It's just like in cooling tower, and likewise the cooling tower and the condenser, atmospheric condenser, has been clubbed, what we call as the evaporative condenser. And this is the atmospheric condenser, very old technology but very much efficient technology, what we say, and maintenance less technology. So these are the various form of condenser what we are using our refrigeration system. Apart from this, you can also use many other form of condenser. We adiabatic one, which has come with a cellulose pad, so that to increase the efficiency. Just putting a pad in this evaporative condenser, we are increasing the further efficiency of the condenser. The fourth important part of our system is the expansion valve. Although we have the three important part, but expansion part valve also plays a very much important role in having the refrigeration effect. Without this, you will not get any refrigeration effect. Although as good as your whatever compressor you operate a condenser, so selection of expansion valve is also very much important. And what does expansion does? Expansion valve creates the low pressure liquid from the high pressure liquid and fit to the evaporator, and likewise creating the low evaporating temperature in your evaporator. There are basically three types of expansion valve available in the market. One is the manual type, second one is the thermostatic, and the third one is the electric or electronic type expansion valve, what you call as nowadays very much used. Manual type are the older technology what we are using in our older system, where a physical globe valve or a hand expansion valve used to be fitted, and we used to control the liquid coming from the receiver, high pressure receiver, to and going to the low pressure evaporator. And thus we were creating the manually the expansion effect in the evaporator by controlling the expansion valve. And these are the basically hand expansion valve used in ammonia refrigerant particularly, where the liquid is being controlled by liquid level controller and the evaporator is fitted by the manual hand expansion valve. And likewise in smaller system, we used to have a capillary type of system where you can fix the temperature what you require in the room or in the evaporator, wherever, and likewise creating the effect by sizing the capillary as per the refrigerant, what the use of refrigerant and the requirement of the refrigerant. The second one is a thermostatic expansion valve, which are very much used and which are very much common, but particularly all must have gone through it. And this is I think the person who have developed this thermostatic expansion valve have got a thorough knowledge of the reference system, because without having that thorough knowledge of reference system, you cannot develop a thermostatic expansion valve. So basically all are using the thermostatic expansion valve, but what I have seen that nobody has got the idea that how the thermostatic expansion valve works. So here I will just brief you how this thermostatic expansion valve works. Thermostatic expansion valve is nothing but having an orifice through which you are metering the flow of your refrigerant, and this orifice is been controlled by a needle, which has been again controlled by a pressure in the diaphragm. In the diaphragm, the same refrigerant is been filled which you are using in your system, and that diaphragm bulb is been kept on the suction line. So as your suction line gets heat up, the refrigerant in the diaphragm gets heat up, and it creates a vapor pressure in that, and by this vapor pressure puts the pressure on the needle and open up the valve. Again, this pressure we call as a P1. There are two again pressure which are used in thermostatic expansion valve, which is a suction pressure and the spring pressure. So that pressure will nullify the vapor in the bellow, that is in the diaphragm, by the suction, actually suction pressure in your evaporator, and the spring pressure which has been defined. So that way you can create an efficient effect, and there is no required of manpower to manually adjust, and thermostatic expansion works on that principle by the superheat of the saturation refrigerant. In the diagram I will show you, this is the diaphragm in which the refrigerant is being filled, and this is a capillary tube and bulb of stainless steel which has been kept on the suction line, and as soon as the refrigerant cycle starts and the refrigerant effects gets created, the vapor in the suction line gets boiled and the temperature is been sensed by this bulb. And likewise, the bulb is also filled with the same refrigerant what we are using. So the refrigerant also gets boiled in the bulb and creates the pressure in the diaphragm. And this diaphragm creates the pressure on the needle and open up the valve. Now, when your refrigerant effect is achieved, the suction pressure is achieved, So same suction pressure is been sensed by the another port in the expansion valve, which is known as the pressure P3 and the spring pressure P2. So this both pressure will then act against the pressure P1 and closes the valve to get the exit, the refrigeration effect, what we want in our refrigerant system. So this is how the thermostatic expansion valve works, and its selection is very much important to make your system very much efficient, not only efficient, but to work. Even to work a system, there should be a proper selection of the expansion valve. Otherwise, your system will be failed and you will not achieve the desired temperature or parameter. So it is very much important in selecting the thermostatic expansion valve. Apart from all the above, if however your good as your system must be, but if you will not select a good expansion valve, then your system will not work. And just like the thermostatic expansion valve, electronic expansion valve also works on the same principle. But over here, we take the help of the electronic instrument to sense the temperature and pressure and give feedback to the controller. And again, the controller gives feedback to the electronic expansion valve, in which there is an inbuilt motor. So the controller gives feedback to the motor to open up the valve as per the requirement of the refrigerant effect in the evaporator. Likewise, it works and it clears the refrigerant effect. So the electronic expansion valve is very much in need of this time, because you can create an efficient system. You can create as much as super rate you require, whatever the super rate or whatever the suction temperature, suction pressure you require, you can control just having the parameter feed in your controller. You can control all your refrigerant system apart from the system at what temperature it has been designed. I mean to say that if you are designing the system for minus application, and now you're thinking, I don't want minus, by the plus application also much satisfied me, then you can just change the parameter in the controller, and you can use the same valve for the positive application also, without changing the any component of your system or any part of the system. So likewise, the electronic expansion valve have come very much handy to a system integrator like us, where we can have end of refrigeration effect by using a single valve. And the cumbersome of selecting a thermostatic expansion valve has been evolved. So electronic expansion valve is very much important in today's day. Apart from all these four equipment, there are other components which I have said are very much useful. And without this, we cannot make a refrigerant system. Likewise, there is a receiver. The receiver also plays a very much important in refrigeration system. But nowadays, since we are going for a compact system and we are going for various refrigerants, the use of receiver has been very much limited, particularly ammonia or the huge refrigerant system where there are large pipeline are involved. So to preserve the refrigerant, to have the refrigerant in a receiver, it is required. So receiver is nothing but a vessel, a pressure vessel, where we can store extra refrigerant, which is very much required whenever the system is not in use, or whenever there is any maintenance to be carried out, or whenever there is any leakage small and in the system, the refrigerant in the receiver helps in maintaining the parameter of your refrigerant cycle. So earlier, this receiver was very much important, since there was a physical and manual cycles were going on. But nowadays, since there are compact and automation cycles have come, the receiver has been rid of from a refrigerant cycle. And in that, but still, before evaluating the receiver, you have to consider the condenser and the evaporator also, volume also, so that you can get rid of the receiver from your refrigerant system. Using the receiver will help you to have a nice refrigerant system with rather than without receiver. So it is also very much important, but you can rid off if time is required. So this is the receiver, what it looks like. It is a pressure vessel in which the liquid refrigerant is being maintained up to half a level so that it did not get pressurized. And likewise, we are saving in, this is the ammonia receiver, what I have shown to you. Basically, it is used in ammonia refrigerant. The other components are the control devices and the instrumentation, which are very much necessary for controlling your refrigeration system, and without which I don't think any refrigeration system can work, because it helps in avoiding breakdown, maintenance in your refrigeration system. It is a safety, what we call it, a safety, just like what we have a safety in our plant. These are all our control devices, the safety of our refrigeration system. So these are also very much important in nowadays to control our refrigeration cycle, our refrigeration system, to control without any help of manpower, so that if any misleading happens in the refrigeration system, the refrigeration system gets closed down, just like flow switch. If there is no flow in condenser or evaporator, so earlier we used to have the freezing and high pressure problem and all this thing. So now if suddenly there is no flow in the evaporator or condenser, the system gets tripped with the help of flow switch or pressure switch, pressure differential switch. And if there is a low pressure in the evaporator, if freezing happens, then also the pressure transmitter or pressure switches are installed, which enable us to say that there is a low pressure in this system. So it is very hazardous for the system to run at this pressure, particularly in a semi-hermetic compressor where the winding has been cooled by the suction gas only. So likewise, we can have the low pressure tripping, high pressure tripping, oil pressure tripping. So all the safeties of low pressure, high pressure, oil pressure can be sensed by this instrument, pressure switch, pressure transmitter, and likewise making a system safe and healthy, and also running the system 24 hours 365 days without any major problem in the system. So these are also very much important component, not even to just sense the parameter, and but also they also controls the pressure. We have a pressure controlling valves and all this thing also to have a constant effect of refrigeration at constant temperature and pressure, so that there is no, particularly for R134, 134A gas is a low pressure gas. So in winter we have a problem of getting a low pressure alarm in the refrigerant. So likewise, we used to have a low pressure control valve which allows the pressure to balance in the system even if it goes below the freezing point. So likewise, we are controlling over all the refrigerant parameters by using this control devices and making our system safe. The another component is the motor and the electrical component. As said by me earlier, the refrigeration is a system where the electricity power consumption is required more. So this power is been transformed in the form of motor what we are using in our refrigerant cycle. These are the prime movers in the refrigerant cycle, and hence we are rotating our compressor and all this thing, creating the refrigerant effect. So motor also plays a very much important and efficient to make the system efficient. Likewise, in today's date, we have got various type of motor from IE3 to IE4, which has come up with the efficiency of around 95% to 97%. So likewise, we have very much improved in our efficiency of our system by using the latest technology, efficient motor. Majority of the motor are, as you know, there are AC induction motor, but as the semi-hermetic compressor are very much used in this date, so we are using the semi-hermetic compressor motor very much in our refrigerant system, which comes either in three phase, two phase, or part winding or split type winding, and have a very much efficient system by avoiding the V-belt or the direct coupled compressor, and just making the motor on the same shaft, and also enabling the leakages, avoiding the leakages of the refrigerant. So semi-hermetic compressor have come good to our refrigeration industry, where we are enabled to make our refrigerant system very much compact, very much efficient, and even the leak proof, and likewise saving our mother ozone layer and all this thing. So motor are also very much vital in selection for the refrigerant system cycle. Also, some electrical components are also necessary, just like to run. There is MCB, but nowadays, as you know, that VFD soft shutter and all this thing have come, which also further enables to save the power by reducing the static torque of the motor and also by varying the various RPM. An inverter technology, what we call as, what we have heard in AC and all this thing, they are not nothing but moving like by varying the frequency, that is a variable frequency drive. So likewise, we are optimizing our FEM system by using VFD and all these electrical components from, and can control our efficient from as much as what we required apart from the design parameter. So likewise, we are increasing, we are optimizing the reference system by using all this motor electrical instrument control. Another component which all again use in our reference systems are the oil separator, oil cooler, accumulator, muffler, vibrator. There are other components which are used in our reference system to make our reference system very smooth with creating the reference system without any without any problem and all this thing. So as I said, oil separator is very much important as it not only helps in preventing the carrier oil from the system, but also protects the compressor for proper lubrication, provides the proper lubrication to compressor. So oil separator and the design of the oil separator is also very much critical, because nowadays the high RPM compressor has come up, like the centrifugal and the screw compressor, which require a precise oil separator and very fine oil separator. So that 99.9% of oil will separate it from the refrigerant, and only refrigerant goes to the evaporator and the oil completely gets separated in the oil separator and likewise feeding back to the compressor. The suction accumulator, which again prevents the carryover of the liquid to the compressor and protecting the compressor from damaging, because as you know, the compressor is only enables to compress the gas and not the liquid. So it is very much important to see that the liquid is not coming to the compressor. And so we must have suction accumulator in our refrigerant system to protect our compressor. This you can get rid of with proper precaution taken in designing of the evaporator. That also is all very much important. If you are designing the evaporator, then you can avoid suction accumulator. But the sufficient space and the you have to see that the liquid gets completely evaporated in the evaporator, then only you can get rid of with the accumulator. The muffler and the vibrating eliminator also very much used to make our system less vibrator, less noisy, and likewise protecting and increasing the life of the reference system. Because it is a need of ours to have a less noisy atmosphere surrounding us. So it is very much important to use this muffler and vibrator eliminator in our refrigerant cycle. Oil filter and suction filter are again the important components, because it not only protects the compressor, but also gives you a constant flow of liquid, flow of gas to the compressor, and the pure flow. Likewise, it has a very much important role in efficient effect. The side glass, moisture indicator, gauges, again, these are the components used to help us in troubleshooting of the reference system. By installing these components, we can easily detect the problem, whether there is a moisture in the system by moisture indicator. By gauges, we can see that whatever pressure we have designed it is having the rated pressure or not. So likewise, these components are very much useful at the maintenance time when we have a problem or troubleshooting in our system. So to get the know-how that what problem is going on in our reference system, these components are very much necessary to install. And we can easily troubleshoot our system easily with the aid of this equipment. So you can see how this looks like. These are the side glasses. Where we can see the flow of liquid refrigerant flowing or not. And in this, there is a moisture indicator also. So likewise, we can come to know whether moisture has been there in refrigerant or not. And if there is a moisture, then it indicates and we can take action accordingly. So it is one of the major components. Vibrating eliminator, as I said, to avoid the vibration and to reduce the noise of our refrigerant equipment, we must use vibrator eliminator, particularly for the reciprocating compressor, where there is a lot of vibration. So likewise, we can have a system with less vibration and less noise. The suction accumulator is a cross section of the suction accumulator. You can see that how the liquid from the evaporator accumulates in this evaporator, and then the compressor sucks from this, and likewise it prevents the carryover of the liquid refrigerant from evaporator to compressor. This is the core filter what we are using to remove the moisture from a liquid refrigerant and also the foreign particles which are come up or which are trapped at the time of fabrication. So core filter also very much important part for the refrigerant system to protect it and to have a nice refrigerant system. After using all this component and after selecting all this component in a refrigerant cycle, the last job comes in the preparation of a refrigerant system, job preparation. In this, you have to see for what application you are making your refrigerant system, what particular desired specification, that is what temperature, SST temperature and the discharge temperature you are selecting. So based on that only, you can design any refrigerant system. Then after you have to calculate the parameter required, like the area of the evaporator, condenser, its MOC and all this thing, then only further you can design your refrigerant system. The third one comes is the designing. After designing all the above equipment, you have to also design the system on which you will keep the skid, that is a design skid on which you will keep all this component and make your system compact and less vibration and with less noisy and all this thing. So after that, calculating area, the designing comes, that's what play a major important role. And after designing, you prepare your drawing, that how the system will looks and how it will be useful for your operating purpose. So then after, you have to design the drawing, detailed drawing has to be carried out. After designing, the completing the drawing, the fifth step comes is the bill of material. From the drawing only, when you will export the drawing, you will get what all material or what all equipment you require for a refrigerant system. So likewise, by preparing a drawing, you can have a BOM easily. And likewise, then after you can submit this BOM to a purchase department where they will procure all the equipment for this refrigerant system and get to your workshop to fabricate, start fabricating the equipment. In fabrication stage also, it is very much important to see that you take all care of cleanliness, quality, then and then only your refrigerant equipment is going to work. Otherwise, if you will not if you're not stringent to your quality, definitely your refrigerant system will not going to work, because there are lot of problems coming up once you design the system. As I said, foreign particles, you will not able to know what is happening to your refrigerant system if you are not cater to the quality at every stage of the refrigerant system while fabricating. So it is not just that you are making a refrigerant system, but the quality is also very much important in making your refrigerant system one from all point of view. From getting the raw material, you have to check the all quality aspect, that the raw material what you have got is of the proper design, proper MOC what you have selected, then is fabrication has been done perfectly. The pressure, you have to carry out the X-ray radiography. It is a pressure vessel, because heat exchanger and all this are a pressure vessel. Then you have to finally also you have to take the pressure testing and all this thing. And then after only, if all everything is complete from quality point of view, your system get ready, and then you can paint it and dispatch the refrigerant system. So this is how we make. First of all, we select all the refrigeration components. We design the refrigeration components, including heat exchanger, all this thing. Then we prepare the drawing, place it on the skid, all this drawing. When this drawing is ready, then only we go for the BOM, complete BOM gets prepared. And then after, our BOM gets to a purchase department and we start fabricating the equipment and see that the equipment is been prepared as per the drawing, as per the design. So these are the how we are making the refrigerant system look like, and you will see this after preparing this drawing, the actual system looks like this, and we see that the system is being prepared as per the drawing. So these are the chillers what we are manufacturing by making proper design as per the client's requirement and all these things. So likewise, one can prepare this refrigerant system by stage wise, by first of all knowing its application, calculating the heat load, selecting the MOC, making the system proper and all these things. So likewise, you can completely design your refrigerant system. Thank you.
Thank you, Jigar bhai. Thank you. It was very wonderful presentation. There are a few questions and there are two hands that have been raised by Mr. Sanjeev Kumar Singh and Anand. So I'll allow Mr. Sanjeev to talk. So you can ask your question, Mr. Sanjeev.
Yeah, please.
Mr. Sanjeev, please unmute yourself. I have already given you the permission to talk. Hello, Mr. Sanjeev. In the meantime, we have few questions, sir. Mr. Sumit Dhoke is asking how to design and size and dia of evaporator coil.
Yeah, Sanjeev, good question. See, evaporative, as I told, first of all, you have to select the refrigerant, which refrigerant you are using. Then after, you have to know what temperature and what flow rate of the medium. If it is air, then what CFM, what velocity. If it is water, what flow rate, what velocity you are considering. Based on that, overall heat transfer coefficient, you have to select whether it is saline tube, what tube and fin type, what tube and tube. You have to select the overall heat transfer coefficient. And based on the overall heat transfer coefficient, you have to calculate the area. Likewise, once you got the area, then after you can get the dia of the cell and all this thing.
So, Mr. Sumit, I hope the answer will suffice your question. There is another question from Mr. Rohit Khatri. He is asking, sir, in household refrigerator and air conditioning, which kind of compressor we are using nowadays?
Yeah, we are using very much hermetically sealed reciprocating compressor or rotary compressor we are using.
Okay. Sir, yes. There is one more question from Mr. Rahul Haridas. Will you please share what actually falling film evaporator is?
Right now I don't have a photo for it. Falling film evaporator is a evaporator in which the water is falling on the plate which is having the refrigerant inside it, and likewise the water gets cooled on the plate itself, and particularly we are using for the slice this ice making, ice slurry making. So likewise forming the ice. We are forming the ice from the water and creating the ice slurry. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes. Hello. Yeah. So can I take next question, please?
Yeah, definitely.
So Mr. Rishabh is asking why to use IKW per ton if we can use COP.
So both are the same phenomena. One can use COP one can use IKW per tier also. So
that is for per ton power consumption.
Per ton power consumption, and that is COP is the nothing but the efficiency of
entire product,
of a compressor of a system. So both are the efficiency only. Yeah, both are the efficiency only. Both are the similar term only. But it is depends. Someone just like in US, what we are using is the COP. Any other part we are using IKW per tier.
Yes. Okay. So next question is Mr. Rohit Khatri is asking, what do you mean by MOC?
MOC is material of construction. That is which material you want to use for your refrigerant system, like copper, MS, SS, the system refrigerant system you are making is from any metal. So material of construction is very much important in selecting the refrigerant system.
Next question, Mr. Mohammad Yusuf is asking, what kind of expansion device is used in centrifugal chiller?
In centrifugal chiller, nowadays we are using electronic expansion device only, because centrifugal compressor works at a high speed. So there is very much abruptly change in the pressure, and that has been precisely controlled by the electronic expansion valve.
Okay. So the same question from Mr. Muhammad Yusuf, that is, what is the purpose of capillary tube in expansion valve? I mean, electronic expansion valve.
There is no capillary tube in electronic expansion valve. Electronic expansion valve works on the pressure transmitter and sensor, which gives feedback to the controller. It is totally electrical and instrumentally devices which are using. So capillary is the manual system, what we used to have in earlier times, having the fixed refrigerant system for a fixed application. But nowadays, since the application and the ambient temperature and all these things are very, very much varying, so we are using the electronic expansion valve to control our system very precisely.
Okay. Sir, can I take next question?
Yeah, please go ahead.
So, sir, why is EEV called constant pressure valve?
Sorry?
Why is electronic expansion valve called constant pressure valve?
No,
I also didn't
get it. Expansion valve is known as a constant pressure valve. All expansion valves are maintaining the pressure constantly, but you can also vary the pressure depending on your application.
Right. Right. Very true. Very true. Sir, he is also asking about, can you just explain what is the overload relay circuit? About overload relay circuit.
Yeah. Definitely. Overload relay circuit is nothing but these are the for the motor you are using it for the protection of the motor. Whenever there is a high ampere, because there is a breakdown in compressor, your motor gets overloaded, or whenever there is a higher requirement or discharge pressure increases, your motor gets overloaded. So the overloaded relay is a safety use to protect our motor in any case when there is a problem in the system, from compressor to condenser or even the motor also, because nowadays the hermetically sealed motor has come. So if motor continuously run on overload ampere, then your motor gets burned, and likewise you have to not only replace the system, you have to completely replace the system, the compressor, because it is hermetically sealed and non-repairable. So overall relay and all these MCB are used particularly for the protection of motor, to protect the motor.
So there are more 10 questions. I like first is from Mr. Vipin. How we can select compressor, condenser, expansion valve and evaporator for one-ton refrigeration system?
Yeah, one-ton refrigeration system, but what is your application? Again, I am saying that based on application, for what purpose you want to, it is an air conditioning, what temperature you want to cater. So one TR in terms of air conditioning also you can talk, in terms of refrigeration also you can talk, in terms of cryogenic also you can talk. So based on your various application and various temperature requirement, first of all, you have to, then only one can design the one-ton refrigerant system.
So there is one more question from Mr. Sumit Doke. How does filter work in DX system?
Filter, the basic purpose of the filter is to remove the moisture and the foreign particles. So not only in DX, every system have the filter. So just like in every system, the purpose of the filter is to remove the moisture and the remove foreign particles. Likewise, in DX system also, it helps in removing the moisture and foreign particles before the liquid goes to the expansion valve, because the expansion valves have a very small, finer hole for expanding effect. And so to not to choke that and to not to have any problem, we are using the filter dryer before the any expansion valve.
The next question, in on what basis expansion device selected?
That is, expansion device is basically selected based on your suction pressure, super heat and the capacity. So these three are the major parameter based on what you are selecting the expansion valve. But again, since nowadays the electronic expansion valve has come, so you can select based on the capacity of the system, you can select it, because you can fit the parameter and you can control the expansion as per your requirement. So nowadays we are selecting the expansion valve based just on the capacity what we require and the application temperature. So likewise, we are selecting the expansion valve and we are using it.
There are a few questions I'll take randomly. Why, how is EEV more energy efficient?
Sorry, why, how?
Why/how is EEV, I think electronic expansion valve, is more energy efficient?
Yeah, because we can precisely control the super heat. We can precisely control the suction pressure and all parameter by the help of, because the transfer, the data transfer of electrical is very much accurate and very much fast compared to what thermostatic expansion valve or manual expansion valve what we are using it. So we are having the better efficient system by using this electronic component. And so this is the need of time. We are nowadays world are going too fast. So electronic equipment has come up aid to our system like us, system indicator, that we are inbuilding electronic expansion valve in our system to make our system accurately work based on the parameter what we have designed.
There is one more question. Please explain in short principle of magnetic centrifugal compressor.
I cannot explain in short. Yeah. This is a very good question. Magnetic principle, you must be knowing the levitation technology. It works on the levitation technology, just like what you use in monorail. Monorail works on the magnetic technology, levitation technology, that the magnetic field has been created to keep apart the two components. So likewise, in magnetic compressor also, the shaft has been levitated and it is rotating on that levitation field. And likewise, we avoid the contact between the bearing and the shaft. And likewise, it is working with oil-free and friction-free. So hence, we are having the better efficiency. That is 0.3 kW per TR we are achieving in magnetic compressor.
Right. Can we use float valve as expansion device in centrifugal chiller?
Sorry, can we use float valve
as expansion device in centrifugal chiller?
Yeah, you can use it. You can use it definitely. Why not? If you are having the manual expansion valve and your chiller is flooded chiller, you can use the float valve to control the liquid level in the chiller, and likewise, you use it as a, not as an expansion valve, but to control a liquid, and you can have a manual expansion valve in your system.
Okay, there are two hands has been raised. One is Mr. Ratan. Ratan sir, I am allowing you to talk, so please unmute yourself and ask you a question. Mr. Ratan, I think while he's coming, how does inverter system is work in current domestic fridge and refrigeration system?
It works on the variable frequency principle.
Right. There are another question. Mr. Ratan, are you there? You wanted to ask anything, or by mistaken you have raised your hand? Okay. Nobody is answering. So I'll go through the next question. What is the logic of program logic control circuit in inverter system?
Yeah, it is a PLC program are very much used in this today's world to control, again to make the system reliable, control efficiently without the help of manpower. We are making the system automated. So PLC programming are very much important part. So various company have various PLC like Siemens, Carol, and all this thing. They have come up with a good PLC equipment which are precisely controlling the system and giving our system very much efficient. So PLC system are very much essential, and time will come that everything will be done on PLC, on BMS system only. So no reference system will be working with the aid of manpower. All automation will be done, and all PLC programming and BMS system will be catering our reference system.
So the next question is, what is the difference between system if you are using refrigerant R410A and R32? What is the difference between system if you are using refrigerant R410A, R32 and R22?
These are the various refrigerants that we are using in the reference system. You can have a reference system with any of these gases, particular to their boiling temperature. So once you R32, what you know that it is a very much flammable refrigerant nowadays we are using. So it is very much critical to handle this refrigerant and to make the system design safely for the use of R32. R22 earlier, now it is banned since it is a CFC refrigerant. So R22 nowadays we are not using it, but it is once it was a very much good refrigerant, and all our system was to be built by R22 only. So R22 is very user-friendly gas. but it is not a ozone friendly gas, so we have banned it. And R32 is a good gas, but again it is very much explosive, so the use of the same is also requires a proper designing of the system and proper handling of the system.
Sir, with us Mr. Amod Dikshit, who is the president of ISHRE Mumbai chapter. So I just would like requesting Mr. Amod sir to say a few words about this program, and also thanks to me give the time vote of thanks to Mr. Jigar, Vinit and Narayan bhai, please.
Hey guys, thank you very much. It was an excellent program, Jigar. Thank you very much for your great explanation of the system. And thanks to my team, Ameya, Akash, Hiten, and everybody. And thank you, Narayan bhai, for being here and to encourage us. You had a fantastic program today, and it's been roughly about an hour and a half. And it's gone beautifully. A lot of questions from a lot of attendees. So keep them coming. Ask them. If we have not answered them, please ask them on the chat box or please email it to us. We will come back to you on those. And unfortunately, I have a 3:30 program again to join somewhere else. So I will have to leave. You can please continue, Amir. Thank you.
Yes, sir, sure.
And see you soon. Thanks.
Thank you, Amod, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, Jigar, sir, how do you want to proceed? Like, I have
you can take it right questions. Now also. I have a time.
Okay. So, we have only 8 questions now.
Yes,
7 now. So, can you, somebody is asking, can you please tell me the factor considering or using while designing the component which are affecting the most?
The factor for designing is the parameter, all the parameter, the MOC, as I told, MOC, then comes your velocity, the pressure, temperature, and all. In designing, it is not that any, all parameter are equal.
Application.
Important. You cannot miss out on a single parameter, because otherwise your system will not work properly. So all parameter are equally important in designing, from single velocity, flow rate, everything of not only the refrigerant, but also the medium to which you want to cool. So all aspects are very much important in designing the reference system.
Okay. Kindly explain thumb rule for home refrigeration system per square feet or one tonnage.
Yeah, you all know that 1000 CFT requires one ton for air conditioning application. So that is a thumb rule. What we all but again, as I said, that if you need 1000 CFT also, if you are putting a heater, then definitely your refrigeration load will increase. So this is just a thumb rule what we are catering for a common application, but not for every application. So based on the parameter that how much person will be there in 1000 square feet, how much temperature, ambient temperature will be there, moisture will be there. So all parameter again plays a very much important role in designing. So there is, we cannot say a thumb rule. We should not never take the thumb rule, in fact, in selecting and designing reference system, because every ambient condition and everything has a different parameter. So based on that parameter only, even the manufacturer say that one ton, my AC is of one ton capacity, but at what parameter? So all aspect you have to see while selecting and designing the refrigeration and air conditioning equipment. You cannot take as a thumb rule, but as we are already taking it practically, so you can take it, otherwise not.
Sir, I have a small question. If you allow me, can I ask my question, please?
Yeah, please.
Sir, now whenever there is a selection of chillers, there are two criteria. One, some people are asking about the full load power consumption, and some people were asking about the part load power consumption. So which one is the correct one, sir, as per your this many years of experience, sir?
Yeah. See, nowadays it is a part load condition what we have to select, because ambient is changing so much fast. There is no constant ambient temperature, there is no constant parameter. So part load efficiency is the major efficiency what we are seeing in selecting a chiller plant. compared to the full load. For process application, okay, where there is a constant load, you can take a full load power consumption and you can select IKW per TR on full load basis, that you can select. But for air conditioning application and all this thing, part load condition is very much important, because if you're selecting a chiller for a mall or hospital, so there is no fix that this much a patient will come every day or this much people will come every day. So if there are the see you consider a mall where daily around 5,000 people used to visit, and someday if 100 people also not going to visit, then what is the condition on your chiller plant? So part at that time part load efficiency is very much important while selecting. So for process application you can consider 100%, but for air conditioning and all this application, part load criteria is much more important.
Okay, thank you, sir. So I think what we will do is, if anybody has any questions, so please write to us on our email ID, that is Ishre Mumbai chapter. Then we will definitely get back to you. And in the meantime, I would like to say thanks to all the attendees who have given us the time and attended this session. Special thanks to Mr. Jigar, Mr. Vinit, Mr. Narayan Bhai, who has come up to came and give us this presentation, wonderful presentation, and it will definitely add into our technical understanding of about the chillers and the technical good things about the basic system of the refrigerations or HVAC system, sir. Thank you, Jigar sir. Thank you, Vinit sir. Thank you, Narayan bhai. So here we are closing the program now. So thank you all the people who have attended this program. Thank you very much. And we will definitely get back to you with some other very good program.